Welcome to the Chapter 11 lecture on the monetary system. In this chapter, we will discuss money, banks, and the Federal Reserve. Let's start off with a quick introduction. If we did not have money in the economy, we would have to rely on barter. Barter is exchange of goods and services for goods and services. Barter is relatively easy when we were kids and we were trading Game Boys or clothes with our siblings. However, barter is much more difficult in a market economy because trade requires a double coincidence of wants. Both traders have to have something the other person wants. As money flows in the economy, it facilitates production and trade. People can specialize in what they do best based on comparative advantage, and total production of goods and services increases, and everyone's standard of living rises. What is money? Economists define money as the set of assets in an economy that people regularly use to buy goods and services from other people. Money has taken many forms throughout history. We have used spices, gold coins, cigarettes, and green pieces of paper with pictures of dead presidents on them as money. As long as the asset we are looking at fulfills the three functions of money, an economist will consider the asset to meet the definition of money. The first function of money is medium of exchange. Medium of exchange is an item that buyers give sellers when they want to purchase goods and services. The second function of money is unit of account. Unit of account is a common yardstick people use to post prices and record debt. Since we all use dollars, we all know the value of a dollar, and we're all on the same page. If we were all using cigarettes as our form of money, we would have that common yardstick to measure the value of goods and services. The third function of money is store of value. A store of value is an item that people can use to transfer purchasing power from the present to the future. Items like spices, gold coins, cigarettes, and green pieces of paper can be used today, tomorrow, next month, or next year. Money is not a perfect store of value because inflation does erode purchasing power over time. But we'll talk about the effects of inflation in the next chapter. One important term to be aware of when discussing money is liquidity. Liquidity is the ease in which an asset can be converted into the medium of exchange. There are many assets that have value, but how quickly they can be converted into money tells us how liquid they are. Cash is the most liquid because it is already the medium of exchange. Stocks and bonds would be less liquid. Your car would be even less liquid, and a home would be the less liquid asset on this list. There are two kinds of money. Commodity money is money with intrinsic value, meaning it has value regardless of use. Examples of commodity money are gold, silver coins, and cigarettes. Gold, silver, and cigarettes can be used as money or also have alternative uses. Fiat money is money without intrinsic value. Fiat money has value only because it is used as money, and it is used because of government decree. On all the bills in your wallet, there's a line that states, "This note is legal tender for all debt, public and private." That is the statement from the government telling you to use this green piece of paper, even though it has no alternative value, as money. Acceptance of fiat money is based on expectation and social convention. Since we all use these green pieces of paper, nobody questions it, and everyone expects it to be accepted when they go shopping. When an economy relies on fiat money, some agency must be responsible for regulating the system. This is where the Federal Reserve comes in. The Federal Reserve is the United States Central Bank. The Federal Reserve is the United States Central Bank. They oversee oversee the banking system and regulate the quantity of money in the economy. The Fed is organized by a board of governors with 7 members. Each member is appointed by the president and confirmed by the Senate. Governors serve 14-year terms, which gives them independence from short-term political pressures. The most important governor is the chairman, who is currently Ben Bernanke. The chairman is responsible for directing Federal Reserve staff, presiding over board meetings, and testifying to Congress about Fed policy. The Federal Reserve System includes the Board of Governors in Washington, D.C., and 12 regional Fed banks located in major cities. You do not need to know all 12 of these cities. I'm just including the map because I think it's pretty interesting to see where each regional bank is located. The main job of the Fed is to regulate banks and ensure the health of the banking system. Under the responsibility of the regional Fed banks, they are going to monitor individual banks' financial conditions and facilitate transactions by clearing checks. They are also going to act as the bank's bank by giving loans to banks when they need to borrow funds. The other main job of the Federal Reserve is to control the quantity of money available in the economy, which is called the money supply, or MS for short. Decisions regarding money supply are called monetary policy. Monetary policy is decided by the FOMC. FOMC stands for Federal Open Market Committee. The FOMC meets every 6 weeks in Washington, D.C. They discuss the condition of the economy and consider changes to money supply. The FOMC is comprised of the Board of Governors, the President of the New York Regional Fed Bank, and 4 other regional bank presidents on a rotating basis. The FOMC can change money supply by conducting open market operations, or an OMO for short. An open market operation is the purchase or sale of a U.S. government bond. When the FOMC purchases bonds, they increase money supply. When the FOMC sells bonds, they decrease the money supply. Let's turn our attention to banks. The behavior of banks can influence the quantity of deposits in the economy and therefore the money supply. Let's start with the simple case of 100% reserve banking to get us familiar with the vocabulary, and then we'll move on to the more realistic example. Let's assume that currency is the only form of money and there's $100. $100 might not be very realistic, but it keeps our math very simple. A bank opens up only as a safe place for people to store their money. All deposits are kept in the bank vault for safekeeping. Deposits that banks receive but do not lend out are called reserves. Because all deposits are held as reserves, this system is called 100% reserve banking. We are going to use a T account to express the financial position of the bank. If you've already taken an accounting course, this will be very easy for you. If you haven't taken any accounting courses yet, don't worry, because we are going to work with very simple T accounts. The left side of the T will be the bank's assets, which are the reserves held in the vault. The right side of the T will be the bank's liabilities, which is the amount the bank owes to depositors. With T accounts, assets and liabilities will exactly balance. Let's draw out the T account for the simple case of 100% reserve banking. Assets are on the left and liabilities are on the right. Under liabilities, we can label deposits and the sum of $100 because that is what is owed to depositors. Under assets, we can label reserves and the sum of $100 because that is the money being held in the vault. The assets and liabilities exactly balance, so we know we've set everything up correctly. With 100% reserve banking, banks hold all deposits in the vault and do not influence money supply. The more realistic scenario is money creation with fractional reserve banking. Leaving all the money in the vault is unnecessary because chances are slim that everyone will want all of their money at any given moment. Banks can lend some of it out, charge interest, and make a profit. A banking system in which banks hold only a fraction of deposits as reserves is called fractional reserve banking. The reserve ratio is the fraction of total deposits that a bank must hold as reserves. The reserve ratio is determined by government regulation and by bank policy. Let's suppose there's $100 in deposits and the reserve ratio is 10%. Again, $100 might not be very realistic, but it keeps our math very simple. With 10% reserve ratio, banks hold 10% of deposits in the vault and lend out the other 90%. Let's look at the T account. Assets are on the left, liabilities are on the right. The $100 of deposits goes under liabilities. The bank holds 10% in the vault, so $10 is labeled as reserve, and the bank lends out the other 90%, so $90 is labeled under loans. Total assets sum to $100 and liabilities exactly balance at $100. Now, money supply is $190. One customer has deposited $100 in the bank, and another customer just got a loan of $90. Combined, the two customers have total money supply of $190. When banks only hold a fraction of deposits in reserves, they create money. The creation of money does not stop after one bank. Let's look at bank number two and assume the customer who received the $90 loan purchases an item with that loan check and the seller ultimately deposits the check into bank two. Deposits are $90. Bank two, like bank one, has a reserve ratio of 10%. So $9 is kept as reserves and the other $81 is loaned out. Now, money supply is $271. One customer has deposited $100 in bank one. Another customer has deposited $90 in bank two. And a third customer just received a loan check of $81. 100 plus 90 plus 81 equals $271. Let's go through one more bank. Assuming that the loan from bank 2 ultimately gets deposited into bank 3, we have deposits of $81. 10% is held in the vault, so $8.10 is kept as reserves. The other 90%, or $72.90, is loaned out. Money supply now adds up to $343.90. There are three customers with deposits of $100, $90, and $81, plus the last loan of $72.90. The process of money creation goes on and on. We could draw another 20 T accounts, but we are going to make life very easy by using the money multiplier, which is an easy way to calculate the total amount of money that banks can create. The money multiplier tells us how much money can be generated with each dollar of reserves. The money multiplier equals 1 divided by the reserve ratio, or M equals 1 divided by RR. In our example, the reserve ratio is 10%. M equals 1 divided by 0.10. Be sure to change the percentage into a decimal. The money multiplier equals 10. For every $1 that is initially deposited into the bank, the fractional reserve system will create $10.